On May the 10th, 1940, German tanks swept into Holland, while paratroopers dropped from the skies onto key targets, closely followed by airborne troops. The Dutch were taken by surprise, but quickly recovered and fought bravely to save Fortress Holland. It was to no avail. On the third day of the invasion, the royal family escaped by sea to Britain. To prevent further bloodshed, the Dutch Supreme Commander, General Winkelmann, gave the order for capitulation. The campaign had taken just 5 days. In the grand Nazi scheme for the subjection of Western Europe, Holland had never been a major target. In October 1939, Hitler had even dropped it from his original plan for the invasion of Holland, Belgium and Luxembourg. The Dutch had been neutral in World War I, and many believed that they would be able to maintain that neutrality and stay out of the fight. But the influx of political refugees from Germany had filled people with foreboding.
Dus je hoorde wat er aan de hand was. Er kwam ook boek uit, de veensoldaten. Maar het was vooral de politieke vluchtelingen die hier ons vertelden wat er aan de gang was. Daar merkte hij al dat Hitler brutaler werd. Inval dus Polen, Tsjechoslowakije. En Nederland dacht, wij dachten allemaal, ik niet. Maar Nederland dacht, regering, wij blijven neutraal. The Duitsers zullen hier niet doorheen komen.
It was geography that sealed their fate. The Luftwaffe convinced Hitler that it needed forward bases to attack Britain, while the North Sea coast could be fortified to create an impregnable defense against retaliation and a base for seaborne invasion. At the same time, the narrow strip of Holland that dangles southwards between Germany and Belgium stood between the Wehrmacht and the key military objective of Maastricht. It was there that the German glider-borne troops landed on the roof of the fort at Ebenemael on the Belgian side of the border and seized control of the bridges of the Albert Canal. Two panzer divisions of the 6th Army swept over Holland and crossed the bridges, heading across Belgium to take on the British Expeditionary Force. As to Holland itself, the plan was to use 4,000 paratroopers of the 1st Parachute Regiment of General Kurt Student's 7th Flieger Division and 12,000 airborne infantry units of the 22nd Air Landing Division to take over the government by seizing the Den Haag, capturing the royal family and taking control of government offices. Other airborne elements would take Arnhem, while infantry divisions pushed through Friesland towards the Eschelmeer.
The Dutch had already decided they were only going to defend certain parts of the country, the parts they could defend behind the water lines, as it were. So Fortress Holland was their defensive area. It meant that they conceded a lot of territory very early on, which looked like a major retreat, but in practice wasn't really. What we know about it suggests the Dutch troops fought very well, but they were outflanked, outgunned, and in the end outmaneuvered as well.
But the invasion of Holland was far from a masterpiece of blitzkrieg warfare. Many paratroopers dropped in the wrong place, and the airborne troops met fierce resistance as their Junkers 52s touched down on the airfields around Den Haag. In this sector of the battle, the Dutch quickly gained the upper hand.
They did manage to mop up a German airborne assault on The Hague, which was an attempt to capture the Dutch royal family, and took something like 1,200 prisoners, who were later shipped to the United Kingdom.
An opportunity was lost when motorized elements of the French 7th Army threatened to cut off a battalion of paratroopers who had been dropped to capture the bridges at Moerdijk, 25 kilometers south of Rotterdam. But the French split their forces to create a defensive line, allowing the 9th Panzer Division that had tricked its way across the border bridge at Hennep and was racing westwards along the banks of the Maas, Bouw and Lek rivers to link up with the paratroop battalion. In effect, Holland had been cut in half. Rotterdam had come under attack in the first hours of the invasion when 12 Heinkel float planes landed on the river in the heart of the city, each side of the Willems Bridge. They took up defensive positions at either end of the bridge, reinforced by paratroopers who had dropped into the sports stadium. All efforts to dislodge them failed, and further troops poured into the city under the air cover of the Luftwaffe.
Het was vooral het overwicht in de lucht, de Luftwaffe, die op beslissende momenten de doorslag heeft gegeven. Het bekendste en meest dramatische voorbeeld daarvan is natuurlijk het bombardement van Rotterdam op 14 mei 1940. Maar ook al daarvoor had generaal Winkelman, de Nederlandse regering, duidelijk gemaakt dat er eigenlijk... dat de strijd niet meer te winnen was.
What appears to have happened there was that as the Dutch forces were being rolled back by the Germans, some negotiations began with the German threat to bomb Dutch cities, because by that stage any Dutch air power had more or less been taken out. And while those negotiations were in train, and indeed I think even after the Dutch had agreed a surrender point, for whatever reason, there was a lack of communication with the German commanders on the ground and with the German Air Force. As a result, the bombing took place anyway.
To this day, it's not clear whether the Germans made any real attempt to call the attack off, or whether they wanted to make an example of Rotterdam. Unarmed civilians were exposed to the full horror of bombing. 980 people died, and 78,000 were made homeless, as a square mile of central Rotterdam went up in flames. With the threat of further bombing held over Dutch cities, Winkelman had no choice but to surrender. The invasion of Holland had happened so rapidly and unexpectedly that at first the citizens hardly knew how to react. Some who felt themselves particularly at risk joined a flood of refugees that clogged the roads. But there was little opportunity to reach the ports and get away on boats. The coast had already been mined, and with German forces sweeping westwards into Belgium and France, there was nowhere to go. Few escaped.
For the rest, it was a question of saying, well, we've already been overrun, there's not much we can do, we're going to have to sit and wait this one out. That was a decision that each individual, each family made, and as a result, most people stayed put.
Ik heb ze binnen zien komen. Niet te geloven, een overmacht en hypermodern georganiseerd en gemechaniseerd, alles, stroomden ze rondom Amsterdam. En vele mensen, want dat was de opvatting ook, van wat moet je tegen zo'n overmacht beginnen? En de opvatting bij velen was, we moeten ons neerleggen bij een langdurige bezetting. Duitsland heeft de oorlog gewonnen. Punt. Klaar. En velen waren zo aangeslagen. Die wilden helemaal niks meer.
At first it was not entirely clear what their new masters intended. The Dutch were perceived as racially very close to the Germans, and there was a belief that they might eventually be converted to National Socialism and absorbed into the Reich. It also simply suited Germany that Holland remained docile and cooperative. So, after about 3 weeks, Germany abandoned plans for a military occupation and brought in a civilian Reichskommissar, Dr. Arthur Seyss-Inquart. He declared that there was no intention to impose National Socialism on Holland, and 20,000 Dutch POWs were released as a gesture of goodwill. The occupiers were at pains to behave in an outwardly correct manner, and unlike Norway, there was no attempt to allow the local National Socialist Party, the NSB, to form a government under its leader, Anton Mussert. The NSB never achieved a membership of more than 4% of the population, but its members were still useful to the occupiers.
Ze vormden het reservoir, het uitzendbureau zou je kunnen zeggen, van krachten die de Duitsers benoemden op belangrijke posten van justitie en bestuurlijk en het bestuurlijke apparaat om hun politiek van nazificatie en economische exploitatie uit te voeren.
The task of the occupiers was made easier by the fact that Dutch administrators had been instructed by the outgoing government to continue running the country in accordance with the laws of war set out in the Hague Conventions. In practice, this allowed them to cooperate with the occupying power to the extent that this did not conflict with the interests of the Netherlands. Many undertook this difficult task with a sense of duty.
There was a large German military presence in the country at that time, but it wasn't intended that they should stay there, and the prime consideration in the initial stages was to try and make sure that Holland could be governed with the minimum amount of resource and manpower that the Germans could possibly manage. In other words, keep it quiet, don't try and do anything to aggravate the locals, and in that way you can use your manpower for more essential tasks further south and then ultimately, of course, against the Soviet Union in 1941.
Meanwhile, Dutch manpower was to be exploited to serve the interests of the Reich. More than 500,000 Dutch labourers were co-opted to work in the German war industry. But the everyday realities of the new order quickly became clear. 50% of Holland's fruit and vegetable production was exported to Germany, with a further 25% commandeered for occupation troops. The Dutch had to make do with the remaining 25%. Shortages and rationing quickly became a way of life. This helped to fuel the sense of outrage that was growing within the Dutch population. Holland had not been occupied since the Napoleonic era and had not been involved in a European war for more than 100 years. The Dutch were ill-prepared for occupation and had no structures in place on which to base resistance, and with no neutral country bordering them, they were effectively isolated. Unsurprisingly, resistance found expression in small, symbolic acts of patriotism. Victory V graffiti appeared, as did OZO, OZO, an abbreviation of the Dutch for Orange Will Conquer. People grew orange flowers in their window boxes in such profusion that eventually the Germans banned them. Queen Wilhelmina and the royal family rapidly became a focus for national sentiment.
De eerste uitzending van Radio Oranje op 28 juli 1940 werd geopend door koningin Wilhelmina. En ondanks de aanvankelijke teleurstelling, soms zelfs boosheid bij sommige Hollanders over het vertrek van de koningin naar Londen, creëerde dat meteen een band. En die band werd alleen maar hechter naarmate de oorlog verliep en de repressie, vooral van de Duitsers, sterker werd. Koningin Wilhelmina werd het symbool van het verzet. Ze werd ook de moeder van het verzet genoemd.
6 weeks after the invasion, large numbers of people wore carnations to commemorate the birthday of the Queen's son-in-law, Prince Bernhard. Interestingly, Bernhard was pure-blooded German, but had declared loyalty to the Netherlands from the start. Pins and jewellery made up of 10 and 25 cent pieces, which showed Queen Wilhelmina's likeness, were very popular. This was strictly outlawed when Dutch coinage was recalled at the end of 1940. Veneration for the royal family deeply offended the occupiers. Eventually, school textbooks were forbidden to refer to them. Any pretense of democratic government evaporated when both houses of the Dutch parliament were suspended a few weeks after the invasion. A month later, the Dutch Communist Party, the CPN, was banned. Shortly afterwards, it started the first edition of its illegal newspaper, De Waarheid, The Truth, shortly followed by other small illegal left-wing organizations. This set the pattern for proliferating underground publications, which were created along political or religious lines. Many were produced on stencil machines.
Die stencils, dat was ook heel handig. Daar had je een soort stencilmoedervellen voor, die kon je oprollen en die kon je bijvoorbeeld ook verstoppen in de buis van een fiets. En dan kon je die weer op een andere plek kon je weer een oplage maken. Voor het transport van de kranten van de ene naar de andere plek waren vaak koeriersters beschikbaar. En dat waren dan meisjes op fietsen die heen en weer fietsten. En meisjes liepen minder risico om te worden opgepakt dan mannen. In de eerste plaats omdat mannen vanaf halverwege 43 verplicht waren om in Duitsland te werken. Dus die liepen een groot risico op controles. Maar ook wel een beetje vanwege het vrouwbeeld dat de nazi's hadden. Die hadden zoiets van, ja, vrouwen zijn toch een soort onschuldige moederwezens en die doen dit soort dingen niet. Dus zeker als je nog een kind op je fiets had of zo, dan kon je meestal gewoon je gang gaan.
The range and variety of illegal newspapers, over 1,300 different titles, reflected the disparate and largely disorganized nature of the Dutch resistance, which persisted throughout the war. Four major ones were established within the first 3 months.
En die check je uit. En dan zei je, denk erom, als je die krant gelezen hebt. Kijk op je afdeling, wil je een krant kan geven. En vertel hem hetzelfde. Wees er zeer voorzichtig mee. Lees hem. En als je iemand weet die betrouwbaar is, geef hem door. En anders neem je hem mee onderweg naar huis en dan gooi je hem in een bus. Want waar ging het ons om? Er moest een anti-Duitse geest komen. Die verslagenheid van de mensen. Die moest je doordringen door de mensen vertellen wat er dus achter dat masker van correctheid schaal ging. Dat wisten wij, dat was moord. Dus het ging erom om het masker van die Duitsers af te rukken en de mensen te laten zien wat die Duitsers van plan waren.
The vacuum left by the ban on political parties was filled by the massive success of the Nederlandse Unie, an ostensibly apolitical movement created on the 24th of July 1940. It attracted 800,000 members in 6 months and took the German domination of Europe as red, concentrating on getting the best deal possible for Holland.
Men wilde vooral ook voorkomen dat de NSB gebruik zou maken van het machtsvacuüm dat was ontstaan nadat de Duitsers in de zomer van 1940 alle politieke partijen verboden hadden. Tegelijkertijd waren er in de top, vooral in de top van de beweging, mensen die niet alleen de Duitse economie wilden aanvaarden, maar ook actief met hen wilden samenwerken voor de inrichting van een meer autocratische, corporatistische staat.
Interesting, the Germans were prepared to welcome it in the initial stages of being something, an organization they could work with. Only when they realized that it was actually a focus for opposition did they then decide it was better off not to be there, and they ultimately shut it down in December 1941.
The initial policy of accommodation had tragic consequences as far as Holland's Jews were concerned. Dutch population registers fell into German hands and greatly assisted the occupiers in tracking Jews down. Responsibility for this fell on SS Brigadeführer Hans Albin Rauter, who held the post of General Commissioner for Security as well as Chief of Police. He controlled the elaborate apparatus of state repression that included the German security police, the SIPO, the Sicherheitsdienst, known as the SD, who were responsible for anti-resistance activities, and the Ordnungspolizei, who maintained public order. The Dutch police continued to handle day-to-day policing, but under Rauter's control. All of the forces available to him were used to enforce anti-Jewish laws and pursue a policy of harassment.
Een nieuwe Joodse wet gekomen dat de Joden mochten, behalve geen fietsen hebben en hier en daar niet meer in en geen parken meer, maar Joden mochten ook niet meer bij niet-Joden werken. En ik was toen gediplomeerd kinderverzorgster. En ik werkte toen in een Joods gezin. Oorspronkelijk werkte ik in een niet-Joods kinderhuis in de provincie. In de provincie Noord-Holland dan. En toen mocht dat niet meer. Joden moesten bij Joden werken.
Celine was only 15 when Dutch members of the Sicherheitsdienst came for her mother and brother, who ran a business in South Amsterdam. She herself avoided being rounded up only because a member of the regular Dutch police intercepted her on the way home.
En toen kom ik langzaam, toen zegt hij tegen mij, bent u juffrouw de Vries? Met zo heet ik met mijn meisjesnaam. Ik zei ja. Zegt hij, doe nou eerst maar die ster af. Toen was ik al heel verbaasd. En dat ging makkelijk, want het was een veiligheidsspeld. En ik heb die ster afgedaan. En zegt hij, je moeder is weggehaald. En ik vroeg hoe hij dat wist. Nou, hij vertelde het dan van buren en mensen die dat wisten. Dat politiebureau, waar een paar goede politieagenten werkten, die zijn dat te oor gekomen. En hij stond dus letterlijk op te wachten dat ik niet naar huis ging.
The policeman helped her to go into hiding with an Amsterdam family. The first of many who concealed her. She never saw her mother or brother again. They died in Auschwitz. Many Dutch men and women came into resistance by taking a principled stand against anti-Jewish legislation. In October 1940, all civil servants were compelled to sign an Aryan declaration designed to root out people with Jewish ancestry. 98% of them dutifully signed without demur. But six Protestant churches and 229 signatories from universities protested. On the 23rd of November 1940, some 3,000 students in Delft organized a strike to protest against the dismissal of Jewish academics. There was similar unrest in the universities of Leiden and Utrecht. The Germans responded by unleashing the WA, the NSB's fighting squads, who were the equivalent of Hitler's brown shirts. One member of the WA was killed in street fighting on Amsterdam's Waterloopplein. The reaction was swift and merciless.
Werd de Jodenbuurt helemaal afgezet en kwam de ordeningspolitie. Toen werden dus 400 Joodse jongens tussen de 18 en 25 jaar, die werden van straat geplukt, fietsen werden ze afgetrapt, ze werden van boven naar beneden gedonderd. En die moesten allemaal, en misschien kan je die foto wel, op het Waterloopplein met hun handen in de hoogte op hun knieën liggen, tot ze door de ordeningspolitie afgevoerd werden. En die jongens, die gingen een zekere dood tegemoet.
This led on the 25th of February 1941 to the first of three major strikes in the Netherlands. The Februarstaking, as it was known, involved thousands of workers in Amsterdam, and it spread to Utrecht, Haarlem and Zaandam.
En ik heb toen het atelier, die afdeling waar ik legde, werkte, dat heb ik platgelegd. En op die afdeling werkten zo'n 40 mensen. Toen naar beneden en totaal werkten daar ongeveer zo'n 150 mensen. En die gingen allemaal mee. Die gingen allemaal mee de straat op. En we gingen overal alle winkels binnen en meelopen, weet je. Want ze willen onze Joodse mensen mee weghalen. En dat is zo echt letterlijk gebeurd. Iedereen. En het aardige van was dat mensen die niet mee durfden te demonstreren, die lachten ons toe en die knikten zo heel stiekem van prima, weet je wel. Maar die durfden verder niet mee te gaan, openlijk. Nou, ik ben er zelf ook erg bang voor geweest hoor, die dag. Dat we gedemonstreerd hebben, want
it was an extraordinary, spontaneous mass protest that caught the occupiers completely by surprise. Rauter responded by sending in the SS and the Ordnungspolizei. With characteristic brutality, they repressed the strike in 2 days. Hundreds of arrests followed.
Maar waar het om ging, dat die staking een inzet was, dat we lieten zien aan de Duitsers dat we wars waren. Walgden van hun bedreven antisemitisme. Daar ging het om. En dat we ons niet hebben laten isoleren van die Joodse mensen. Terwijl de staking aan de mensen een bewustzijn heeft gegeven. Hey, die Duitse bezetter is niet onoverwinnelijk. We kunnen wat doen, want ze kropen weer uit een hol. De mensen waren weer durfden weer wat. En daar ging het om. Want vanaf die februaristaking kreeg je dus dat het verzet ook tegen de Duitsers zich ging bundelen en in kracht toenam.
In the month following, three communist strikers and 14 others were executed in reprisal. These were the first executions to take place, and they put an end to attempts to conciliate between the occupiers and the Dutch population. Seyss Inquart's policy of correct behavior had been exposed for the sham it was. Opposition to his regime hardened and was to increase in the months and years to come. As the Dutch came to understand the true nature of the Nazi regime, passive resistance, hoarding food and slowing work, increased, as did listening to Radio Oranje. There were demonstrations, finally suppressed in September 1941, followed by a German decree in October 1941 that anyone committing public order offences would be killed. The remaining Dutch political parties were formally dissolved at this time, and in December, Nederlandse Unie was also disbanded as untrustworthy. Many of its leaders became involved in underground activity, but the nature of Holland's plight made this difficult as well as dangerous.
And one has to remember that at that stage, it appeared on the face of it that there was no long-term alternative to continuing German rule. Britain was more or less on its knees at that stage. There was no help to be had from anywhere else. So these people who are setting out to confound the Germans are bucking a trend, and perhaps even you could almost argue they're engaging in behaviour which is almost suicidal, because there's no obvious point of contact where help might arrive.
The Germans forced the pace of Nazification by placing all organisations under National Socialist control. It was not a success. Trade unions controlled by the NS lost members. Farmers, smallholders and fishermen boycotted the Nederlandse Landstad, the organisation set up to coordinate their activities. Most professions refused to cooperate. The churches continued to protest, and Nazification made little headway in the school system. An increasing number of opponents of the regime went underground, becoming what the Dutch called onderdijkers.
It was often enough for people not to be where they were supposed to be, in other words, not to be in the places where they were registered as part of the population. That often meant that they had to have forged ID cards, forged ration cards, and so on and so forth, in order to survive. But the reality was that they were in a position to evade German capture at a bureaucratic level, simply by removing themselves from the places that they were supposed to be resident in.
The first onderduikers were communists and other political opponents of the regime, Jehovah's Witnesses, homosexuals, and the Jews. They and the families who hid them were in constant danger of discovery or betrayal.
Dat we hadden eensteensmuurtjes, dat is de, tegenwoordig heb je dat niet meer. Maar je kon zelfs horen als je buurman hoestte. Dus laat staan als je een gezin opnam, dat kon eigenlijk niet. Dat was de moeilijkheid, dat veel mensen eigenlijk door onwetendheid, daar ging men over praten. Nou, die buurman, dat is ook wat moois. Zo'n oude man, hij heeft een jonge vrouw in huis met kleine kinderen, bijvoorbeeld. Ik geef nou maar een voorbeeld. Zo ging dus verraad. Anderen hoorden dat en dachten, oh, wacht, begrijp je wel? Zo is dat gegaan. Het is niet omdat Nederland zo slecht was, maar omdat in dorpen en in buurten veel gekletst werd. Klap, klap, klap. Ja.
Ik zat in een huis met een moeder en een kind. Vader zat in Duitsland als gijzelaar, als dienst. En ik neem dat ik aan dat ik van haar, je bent door een goede kennis van mijn moeder. Die toch al haar eigen vader verraden heeft trouwens, want die was communist. En heeft samen met haar moeder, want die familie van de moederskant waren allemaal nazi's. Waarschijnlijk is mijn moeder ook door diezelfde mensen toen ook verraden, die met mijn broer samen toen ze is opgepakt. Ze hadden het hele huis omringd. Voor stonden mannen, het waren allemaal mannen van de Nederlandse Sicherheitsdienst, van de Nederlandse politie, maar in Duitse dienst. En achter stonden ze en kwamen zo dat trappetje hoog, tikte tegen het ruit, want het natuurlijk was achter oog gesloten. En toen moest mijn vrouw, waar ik in huis was, Miep heette ze, die deur openmaken. Toen kwamen ze binnen. U heeft een onderduikster in huis? Nee, zei ze nog. Dat was, maar die is weg. Nee, zei ze, die is niet weg. Dus ze gingen alles onderzoeken. Ze maken de kast open, daar zat ik in.
By extraordinary good fortune, Celine was released because a sympathetic member of the SS said that she worked in a factory making army uniforms. It was a lie, but it saved her life. Most were not so lucky. Over 107,000 Jews were rounded up and deported to concentration camps.
Ik ging met een Joodse familie om, hè? Al van kind, kleinkind af aan. En die hadden 5 kinderen. Jetje en Barend en Pinny en Levi en Sally. En dan had je die moeder, tante Tootje, en die vader, oom Hartog. Allemaal opgepakt, allemaal weg. Dat is niet voor te stellen, hoor. Dat zijn niet te begrijpen dingen. En ik heb dan ook echt moeten leren om daarover te praten zonder in huilen uit te barsten. Anders kan je niet meer praten. En dan denk ik, Je moet praten, je moet het vertellen.
Organisations were formed to help hide Jews, especially children. 4,000 children were saved in this way, but sometimes it ended tragically.
Wij hebben toen opdracht een keer gekregen om bijvoorbeeld kinderen naar de Biesbosch te brengen. Dat is in het midden van het land. Dat is een gedeelte wat een beetje met allemaal kleine kanaaltjes, maar dat was voor de Duitsers te gevaarlijk, want dat was een moerasgebied. En daar kenden alleen Nederlanders die daar in de buurt woonden de weg. Er lag een grote roeiboot, een jol. En ik wees een jongetje van 14 jaar aan om met mij die roeiboot naar de overkant te brengen van de rivier. Want ik had nog nooit aan een rivier gewoond. Ik wist niks van rivieren. Ik kwam uit Noord-Holland, waar geen rivieren zijn. En er was een sterke stroom. En we zaten allemaal in de boot en toen kwam er een zoeklicht. Zo, en die bleef op onze boot. En toen ging dat jongetje ging staan en die riep, rotmoffen. Hij wilde ook een daad stellen. Mitrieerde ze. En toen sloeg hij overboord en alle kinderen overboord. Maar we waren al halverwege op de rivier. En allemaal verdronken op één kind. Nou, dat is het drama van mijn leven. Daar heb ik, kijk maar, ik er altijd een beetje bibberig van als ik erover vertel.
In the summer of 1942, the Nazi regime brought in further measures that outraged the civilian population. Radio sets were confiscated, and the Germans began to round up as many bicycles as they could find.
The bicycles were clearly intended for German military use, and the radio sets were an admission, if you like, that the German propaganda machine was having no luck in persuading the Dutch they should all be good National Socialists. And that, in fact, what the Dutch were doing were all listening to clandestine broadcasts and broadcasts from London, which they weren't supposed to hear. So, from that point of view, these two measures in the summer of 1942, in a very real sense, made large sections of the Dutch population think of breaking the law for the first time. In other words, that rather than hand in their nice new bicycles to the Germans, they would find an old frame or some old wheels in the back of the shed and hand those in, and take their bicycles and bury them in the back garden or whatever.
German defeats in North Africa and on the Eastern Front had an impact on the mood of Dutch civilians, but also on the German authorities. As rumours of a second Allied front in Europe began to circulate, the Germans feared that demobilised Dutch soldiers and those who they'd freed from POW camps might rush to join the Allies. At the same time, the German need for industrial labour became critical. On the 29th of April 1943, the German military commander, General Christensen, decreed that all former members of the Dutch army must report for internment in Germany. A wave of spontaneous strikes broke out in response.
500.000 mensen legden het werk neer. Het begon in de industriegebieden in Twente, maar breidde zich als een olievlek uit naar andere industriegebieden in Nederland. De Duitsers reageerden hard. De martial law werd afgekondigd, standrecht. En er werd in die eerste week werden er 175 mannen geëxecuteerd. Maar het waren de stakers zelf die de staking beëindigden. Ze hebben niets meer en niets minder willen doen dan uiting geven aan hun verontwaardiging over deze maatregel.
Soon afterwards, the compulsory labour scheme was extended to include all men between 18 and 50, with students, former soldiers and industrial workers especially targeted. Many became onderdakkers. Only 7% of the male labour force required was actually delivered.
Toen in de zomer en najaar van 1943 opeens veel meer Nederlandse mannen een onderduikadres behoefden, kleding en voedsel nodig hadden, werd besloten tot de oprichting van een aparte organisatie, de landelijke knokploegen, die zorg zouden dragen voor de verzorging van die onderduikers, in de zin dat er voedselkaarten, distributiekaarten gekaapt moesten worden. En dat werd gedaan door gewapende overvallen op distributiekantoren, op gemeentehuizen.
The very passivity of their new existence prompted many Onderdaukers to become involved in resistance activities. But it was not easy in a small, densely populated country with no mountains or forests in which to hide and a transport infrastructure that allowed German infantry units or security forces to be anywhere in the country in a couple of hours. Unlike resistance organizations elsewhere, they were receiving very little help from outside the country. SOE's attempt to parachute in agents had gone disastrously wrong. The Abwehr counter-espionage unit captured one of them and forced him to transmit a message to London requesting that further SOE agents be dropped. London ignored the fact that the message had been sent without security elements in the code, which in effect meant that the agent had been compromised. Unforgivably, they replied. For over 18 months from March 1942, virtually all arms, ammunition, explosives and agents dropped by SOE fell into the hands of the SIPO. 54 SOE agents were captured and sufficient arms to equip 15,000 resistors were lost.
De Engelsen hebben daarop in de periode maart 42, november 43 enorm veel wapen- en munitiedroppings, maar ook agenten gedropt boven Nederland die dus alle in Duitse handen vielen. Dit is een van de grootste mislukkingen, een van de grootste spionageschandalen geweest van de Tweede Wereldoorlog, van de SOI, het zogenaamde Englandspiel. Meer dan 123 agenten vonden de dood en veel meer geraakten in Duitse gevangenschap.
As a result, Dutch resistors operated in very small groups without support or overall coordination. They undertook acts of sabotage and targeted traitors and members of the security forces for killing.
Je kon niet anders dan zo'n gezwel uit de maatschappij halen als een chirurg alsof die een gezwel weghaalt, een kankergezwel. Dat moesten we dus helaas doen. En dat was het werk wat we wel hebben gedaan, maar geloof me nou, het was niet zo alsof we als cowboys door het leven gingen en van de heup alsmaar nazi's neerschoten. Zo was het niet, maar er zijn er wel bij, zijn er wel gedood. Ja, het waren geen mensen meer hoor, hou me te goede, want ik vind niet dat ze het woord menswaardig waren, want zij verrieden Joodse families die nooit terug zijn gekomen. Er waren babytjes bij. Daar kregen ze wel 35 gulden per stuk voor. Alsof het slachtvee was. En dat vind ik het bepalende daarvan. Ik heb er ook nooit spijt van. Ik heb nooit een gevoel gehad van dat had ik niet moeten doen. Wel dat we minder kinderen hebben kunnen redden dan we hadden gewild.
German reprisals for resistance activities were swift and ruthless. In August 1942, five hostages were killed after a sabotage attempt on railway lines near Rotterdam. From then on, the figures multiplied. Trusch Menger and her colleague Hanni Schraft, a famous heroine of the Dutch resistance, were in Haarlem when a prominent Dutch Nazi, Farkas Christ, was shot. They did not take part in the killing, but witnessed the consequences.
Toen hebben ze daar vier huizen in de brand gestoken en een twintigtal of twaalftal, dat weet ik niet meer, verzetsmensen werden geketend aan elkaar. Die zijn daar met een salvo van een geweer, van geweren, zijn ze daar geëxecuteerd. En dat was bij een grote kathedraal en voor. Ze stonden er allemaal en er werden commando's gegeven. En dan wordt het heel stil. Al die mensen die gedwongen waren om te kijken, kinderen, oude vrouwen, oude mensen. Er waren niet zoveel mannen die nog wat hadden kunnen doen of zo. Niets. Want die waren allemaal weggevoerd. Die zaten ondergedoken of noem maar op. En die stonden daar allemaal. Het werd heel stil. En toen was er een oude man, en dat zal ik nooit in mijn leven vergeten. Ik ben een revolutionair, Maar, en het Wilhelmus zei me eigenlijk nog niet zoveel, maar toen wel. Toen begon die oude man het Wilhelmus te zingen met zo'n beverige oude mannenstem. En toen kwam dat salvo.
Efforts to support the resistance were stepped up. Forging of false papers was increased. Production of newspapers burgeoned. The Normandy landings in June 1944 gave a huge boost to Dutch morale. And when Allied forces advanced as far as Maastricht on the 14th of September, it seemed as if the end was not far away. The government in exile in London called for a general railway strike in support of the airborne assault at Arnhem on September the 17th.
In other words, if the railway workers weren't there, specifically the signalmen and the essential staff, then the Germans wouldn't be able to use the railways to reinforce their troops in and around Arnhem. Because the Allied airborne landing failed to meet its objectives and was driven back, and the Northern Netherlands remained in German hands for another 7 months, this left the railway workers with something of a problem, in the sense that if they went back to work thereafter, they would be victimised by the Germans and possibly locked up, possibly shot, possibly deported to Germany, put in a concentration camp.
Very few dared to return to work and went into hiding, swelling the ranks of the Onderdaukers to an astonishing 300,000. The Germans decided to use the strike as an excuse to take reprisals against the civilian population. Once the canals froze and barges could no longer be used to transport food in from the countryside or coal from the mines, there were widespread shortages in the major Dutch cities. During the infamous hunger winter of 1944-45, between 15 and 20,000 people died of cold, exhaustion, disease and hunger. For many, these final months of occupation were the bitterest time of the whole war. The final months of the war in Holland was the hardest period of all for ordinary people, with bodies in the streets, extreme cold, lack of fuel, scarcity of food and forced population movements. The grim cycle of attack and reprisal continued. In the course of the war, the British and Americans flew huge numbers of bombing missions that took them over Holland en route to Germany. Many who were shot down ended up parachuting into Holland or making their way back there from Germany. The Dutch, skilled at dealing with Onderduikers, took them in.
In goeiedag kwam zo twee piloten. En die zeiden of ze bij ons mochten komen van het verzet. En die zijn een paar dagen in de schuur geweest. En toen moesten ze een plaats hebben naar boven. En ja, nou deed ik altijd voor het eten zorgen. Mijn moeder kon dat niet zo goed allemaal. En zo zijn we geleidelijk ingekomen. En iedere keer kwam er één bij.
One of the aircrew was Frank Dell, a Mosquito pilot who had been shot down over Duisburg and had made his way into Holland, ending up on the Prinsen's farm and having to hide from the Germans who were billeted there.
I think there were three sleeping on little piles of hay immediately underneath us. There were three or four sleeping inside the truck, and there were two or three sleeping on the other side of the hayloft. So that was the dangerous time. And of course, the German soldiers mixed with the family. We could hear them in the evening sitting around the kitchen table, exchanging little jokes. I remember they would all sing together once in a while, this sort of thing. But of course, there was always the danger the children might have said something that would have let the cat out of the bag.
Frank and his companions were hidden in various locations over the months, including a derelict farmhouse which they shared with members of the local resistance. He very quickly became absorbed in their activities, training them in the use of weapons dropped by the Allies.
Frank had them also needed by the weapon droppings, because he could hear the sound of the motor or if it was an English vehicle. It was very good, because he was rustig and hij sprak perfect Engels. Dat is heel wat anders dan die Amerikanen, want die hadden een soort slang. En toen was het ook minder moeilijk om Engels te praten, want toen was het nog niet zo lang van school.
Over 220 equipment drops, consisting of some 30,000 arms, were made over Holland. These allowed for a considerable increase in sabotage activity. But the main aim of Coe and his companions was to try to get the pilots back into the hands of the Allied forces, which by this stage had advanced as far as the Rhine. Several attempts were made.
Toen kwam er een mogelijkheid om bij Emmerich over de Rijn te gaan. Er is al afscheid genomen, er is extra pudding, dacht ik, nog hebben gegeten. En dan ging het niet door, want die dag ervoor waren de boten lek geschoten. De volgende keer zou er weer een poging zijn. En dat ging ook niet door, want de man die daarmee te maken had, diens huis was gebombardeerd.
Shortly afterwards, the Allies fought their way across the Rhine and advanced eastwards. Frank made contact with a reconnaissance unit of the Household Cavalry. He asked them politely for a jeep to collect his companions from the farmhouse.
Very soon, a jeep, in fact, did arrive. And then we drove in the jeep back to the farm to link up with the others. And there was then a very poignant moment, because we all stood by this jeep, ready to climb aboard. And in the space of 5 minutes or so, we'd said goodbye to this family, who for all these months had been risking their lives to hide us and help us and so on. We said goodbye and were gone.
In the final months of the war, Holland's resistance groups finally united under the leadership of Prince Bernhard. Their main function, as the Allies saw it, was to maintain order in between the German surrender and the return of the government in exile. Many felt that they had been cheated of the chance to engage in combat when the Germans finally capitulated. But it brought an end to the killing and relief to a beleaguered civilian population. Holland had suffered enough.
The drama series Rome continues tomorrow night at 9 o'clock here on Knowledge. Back to this Good Friday evening, where the history of the First World War has reached the spring of 1918. How the Allies withstood Germany's last gamble on the Western Front in just a moment.